Well, hello, welcome to our service again. I am away on holiday, but this service is taken then by Geraint this week. So thank you, Geraint, for your word. We look forward to hearing that word later on. But before then, we're going to pray together. Let's commit the service and our time and each other to God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and this privilege of coming before a holy God, and yet a God who is so great, and yet who wants to know us and who loves us and draws near to us. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that you love us so much that you gave your only Son to die in our place. And Lord, we want to say that we love you and we thank you for the gospel, for the Lord Jesus, for salvation. Lord, we thank you that we can come to you again, come to the Bible, and that we can meet with you through the Bible. We thank you that this Bible is the living word, and that it speaks to us, that you speak to us through it. We thank you that this is your word, it's trustworthy, it is holy, and we thank you, Father, that we can depend fully on it. And so we pray, Father, for open ears and open hearts to listen to and to respond to this word that you have given us again and that you've given Geraint to preach to us. And so we pray, Holy Spirit, move among us. We pray, Father, have your way among us. And we pray, Father, that all things that we do in this service, Father, and everything in response to this service would glorify your name and exalt the name of Jesus Christ higher than any and every other name, as he is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And so we give him glory and praise. We pray then for the service. We pray, guide us through the service now, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Reading from God's Word this morning comes from the book of Genesis and verse 32. Jacob also went on his way, and the angels of God met him. When Jacob saw them, he said, "This is the camp of God." So he named that place Mahanaim. Jacob sent messengers ahead of him to his brother Esau in the land of Seir, the country of Edom. He instructed them, "This is what you are to say to my master Esau. Your servant Jacob says, 'I have been staying with Laban and have remained there till now. I have cattle and donkeys, sheep and goats, men servants and maid servants. Now I am sending this message to my lord, that I may find favor in your eyes.'" When the messengers returned to Jacob, they said, "We went to your brother Esau, and now he is coming to meet you, and 400 men are with him." In great fear and distress, Jacob divided the people who were with him into two groups, and the flocks and herds and camels as well. He thought, "If Esau comes and attacks one group, the group that is left may escape." Then Jacob prayed, "O God of my father Abraham, God of my father Isaac, O Lord, who said to me, 'Go back to your country and your relatives, and I will make you prosper. I am unworthy of all the kindness and faithfulness you have shown your servant. I had only my staff when I crossed this Jordan, but now I have become two groups. Save me, I pray, from the hand of my brother Esau, for I am afraid he will come and attack me, and also the mothers of with their children. But you have said, 'I will surely make you prosper and will make your descendants like the sand of the sea, which cannot be counted.'" He spent the night there, and from what he had with him, he selected a gift for his brother Esau: 200 female goats and 20 male goats, 200 ewes and 20 rams, 30 female camels with their young, 40 cows and 10 bulls, 20 female donkeys and 10 male donkeys. He put them in the care of his servants, each herd by itself, and said to his servants, "Go ahead of me and keep some space between the herds." He instructed the one in the head lead, "When my brother Esau meets you and asks, 'To whom do you belong and where are you going and who owns all these animals in front of you?' then you ought to say, 'They belong to your servant Jacob. They are a gift sent to my lord Esau, and he is coming behind us.'" He also instructed the second, the third, and all the others who followed the herds, "You are to say the same thing to Esau when you meet him, and be sure to say, 'Your servant Jacob is coming behind us.' For he thought, 'I will pacify him with these gifts I am sending on ahead. Later, when I see him, perhaps he will receive me.' So Jacob's gifts went on ahead of him, but he himself spent the night in the camp. That night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two maidservants, and his 11 sons, and crossed the ford of Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip, so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, Let me go, for it is daybreak. But Jacob replied, I will not let you go unless you bless me. The man asked him, What is your name? Jacob, he answered. Then the man said, Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with men and have overcome. Jacob said, Please tell me your name. But he replied, Why do you ask my name? Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared. The sun rose above him as he passed Peniel, and as he was limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the tendon attached to the socket of the hip, because the socket of Jacob's hip was touched near the tendon. And I'd like to look with you this morning at the passage that was read and think particularly of Jacob's words in verse 26. I will not let you go unless you bless me. Unless you bless me. Blessing is a very precious word for us. As Christians, we use it often in our greetings, perhaps, as we say farewell, we may say, God bless you, or every blessing. And certainly in our prayers, some of us perhaps would have difficulty going on in prayer were it not for that word, blessing. It comes up so often, and some perhaps have said that we overuse this word and say perhaps the only cure to this overuse is not to use the word at all. When we ask God to bless, to say what we mean. Do we mean that we want him to convert this person, or that we want these circumstances to be changed, or we want them to have strength? Why can't we be more specific? Perhaps we can be more specific, but not at the expense of this wonderful word, bless. Perhaps what we need to do is not forget about the word altogether, but to the contrary, understand this word. Understand what we mean when we ask for blessing, when we seek blessing. And I think this chapter in Genesis is a help to us in that regard. And there are many things that we could say, but I'd like to look at three things in particular. Firstly, that blessing is a gracious gift of God. A good thing that God gives in his grace. It comes from him. And you see that even in the words of Jacob, short though they are, I will not let you go unless you bless me. I can't make a blessing for myself. I can't find a blessing by looking here and there or by working at it for a number of years. You can bless. And Jacob, we'll see perhaps more as we go on, but he is aware that he's not talking to an ordinary man. He's not talking to somebody just like him, or perhaps a little bigger, greater than he is. He's quite aware that there is something distinct. This person is sent by God, represents God. And indeed, we read, we can infer at least from verse 30, I saw God face to face. Is God present with him? And he's asking him, he's begging him, pleading with him for blessing, which is something only God can give, and is something that God gives in abundance. We read at the beginning of the book of Genesis, don't we, that God created the world and Adam and Eve, and then we read these words, he blessed them. All this creation was before them, and he blessed them. Of course, sin came in. Sin undid something of that blessing, and in the place of blessing, curse came. The ground was cursed. Man would be cursed because of sin. But nevertheless, even the curse couldn't wipe away the blessing-giving character of God. As we read a little later in Genesis, he comes to Abraham, and the great promise he makes to Abraham, I will bless you. I will bless your seed, and by your seed all the nations of the world will be blessed. And we read on in the Bible, don't we, how not only is it this confined to one family, but this family becomes a nation. This nation was enslaved in Egypt. God brought them out and blessed them. As they went through the wilderness, he commanded that the words of blessing, the Lord bless you and keep you, those words would ring in their ears on a daily basis, the Lord's blessing. And when people hired false prophets to curse them, God so overpowered them that even they were compelled to bless this people. And eventually we read, of course, in the fullness of time, God's blessing come in Jesus Christ on his people, his church. God's blessings flowing down, every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus coming to his people. God's love, God's forgiveness, God's peace, God's strength, God's provision, all those blessings, blessing upon blessing. That is the God who reveals himself in the Bible and who reveals, he makes himself known in Jesus Christ, the God who blesses. And blessed are you if you know something of that blessing. It's been a funny time, isn't it? It's been, how many times have you heard the word unprecedented over the last couple of months? And everything is unprecedented. We've never had something like this, certainly in our experience. Nothing to compare these last few months with. Things, our routines have been turned upside down. And through all of that, God has been blessing us. We see some of this perhaps on the WhatsApp accounts. People have been mentioning the blessings that they've had. And then in the other meetings we've been able to have, people again mention some of the blessings that they've had, but only some of them. And it would be too much, I think. WhatsApp couldn't cope if we were to number all the blessings that God has given. This is the God that we have. And as we hope perhaps to come out of lockdown sometime, as we hope
a vaccine will be found eventually, which will work, which perhaps will take away the fear of this terrible illness. We still have to adapt to the circumstances in which we find ourselves. Oh, but what a difference it makes to know that there is a God who blesses. We haven't been able to meet as a church for how many Sundays? Any mathematicians listening, watching? How many Sundays has it been? And if you count two services on Sunday, you double it then. And count the midweek meetings as well, when we haven't been able to come together. Well, that is true. Nevertheless, even in all those difficulties, God has blessed us. Perhaps we were worried at the beginning. Perhaps we didn't know what was going to happen. How were things going to develop? And God has surprised us with his blessing. Perhaps it's been a difficult time for us. Perhaps we've had our difficult moments. Perhaps we haven't been at our best all the time. It hasn't been easy for the other people in the house with us. And nevertheless, God has blessed us. And we can look to him this morning now as we come under his word in our homes. Well, we can look for all sorts of things, can't we? But surely this should be in the front of our minds. Oh, that the Lord would bless us. Not just me, of course. The people who are with us, watching this with us. The people in other houses, people known to us in the church and other churches, known to us. We're all in this together. Oh, that the Lord would bless us. Only he can do that. And he is generous in his blessing. So we can be realistic. We can see the problems. We can look at the problems, but not despondent. Because we have a God who blesses. Oh, I will not let you go until you bless me. A gracious gift of God. And secondly, we can say that a blessing is a gracious gift of God which is to be sought from God. And this is where perhaps the idea, the biblical idea of blessing parts company from the worldly idea of blessing. If the person in the world were to use the word blessing, perhaps he'd have another word for it. Perhaps he'd talk about something fantastic, something great, something out of the world, the best thing that could have ever happened to me. He'd mean perhaps a lot of things, but for many people, that would mean, is it Saturday night that the numbers are read out and you've got your lottery ticket there and all those numbers come up and you find out that you've just won £50 million. £50 million or more, perhaps. And there we go. Well, the best thing that has ever happened to me. Oh, forget about the mortgage. Forget about the small house. Forget about the staycation. Whoa, the sky is the limit. Everything's coming in now. All these blessings. No more worries. No more problems. Even perhaps the health problems. Well, perhaps money will be an answer to those as well. Everything changed overnight. The sky is blue. The sun is up. And it's never going to set. Good things after good things after good things. We don't know what to do with them all. Well, Perhaps that's what the world dreams of. We can be grateful that the Bible gives us another picture. We can be grateful that the Bible helps us in the world in which we find ourselves. You think of the people who are blessed in the Bible. You think of people like Job. Well, you know, he had it all at the beginning, and then he lost it all. He lost his wealth. He lost his family. He lost his health, so that he could find God's blessing. Or David, there he was. He'd come from obscurity, playing his harp in the king's palace. And then the king turns against him, gets jealous of him, and he has to flee for his life, so that he would find God's blessing. Or Paul, you know, won't tire you with all the people, but you know, these are the people we're presented with in the Bible. Or in Genesis, to get closer perhaps to our context. Think of the end of Genesis. Think of Joseph. Well, his brothers turn on him, want to kill him, but decide or are dissuaded from that and sell him into captivity. And there he is, falsely accused, his reputation in tatters, sent to prison. And God blesses him. God blesses him in the midst of adversity. And let's come closer still now to our context. Here is Jacob. What a life, what a life. You know, he deceives his father, his big brother is upset and wants to kill him, so he has to flee for his life. He ends up with his uncle, and his uncle deceives him, and he's having a rough time, and he ends up with more wives than he'd anticipated. And all these difficulties, and then eventually he decides to return to the land that he'd fled previously. And as he returns, he hears now that the brother, the big brother he'd left who wanted to kill him, is on his way to meet him. And it's not just the big brother he's got to worry about, but there are 400 men with him. What is Jacob going to do? He's thinking, and he's starting to try to work a way out, but he just can't see a way through it. He sends people before him to prepare a way for him, and he starts, in the midst of his adversity, he starts to pray. He starts to call. You know, not the first thing he does, but eventually he does. We read in verse 9, don't he? O God of my father Abraham, he remembers the promises God has given him. God gave him as he left the promised land initially. God of my father Isaac, the promises God had given not only to Abraham, but also to Isaac. O Lord, who said to me, go back to your country. I'm coming here as you have told me to come, and I will make you prosper. I've got all these promises before you. I am unworthy of all the kindness and faithfulness you have shown your servant. I only my staff. You've been so good to me, but now I've become two groups. Look at all the ways that you bless me. Save me, I pray, from the hand of my brother Esau. He's seeking God now in adversity, in trial, seeking the blessing of God. And he carries on, and we read, though he's asked this, he's still hoping now. He sent this gift on. He hopes that surely that this gift might placate his brother. And then we come to the passage that we're looking at particularly, where this figure, this mysterious person, this man that we read about, who is more than a man, who is God present with him in this form. And this person is wrestling with him, striving with him, struggling with him, as if he wants to get away from him. And Jacob is grasping him as best he can, laying hold of him, wrestling, continuing to wrestle with him. We don't know more than is told to us here about this wrestling. You know, it's easy perhaps to let your imagination run wild. Possibly the person is trying to encourage or to force Jacob on, and Jacob doesn't want to go. Jacob doesn't feel ready, or bringing Jacob up to a special state in himself. And again, Jacob is resisting this and looking just for the blessing. But whatever it is, this person seems to be the exact opposite to what Jacob expected. Jacob expected God to come and perhaps to get rid of those 400 men who were with Esau, or perhaps to bring him some news that he needn't worry so much about what's to happen. Things were going to be fine, to give him some peace in his heart. And this person is fighting with him. It's almost as if this person is against him. And I wonder if there's not a lesson for us here. You know, we're keen, of course, and we want to encourage one another. So we like to mention the blessings that we've had. We like to mention the good things God has given us. Certainly, we don't want to complain. We don't want to have the reputation of being mourning minis. But if we were honest, perhaps our WhatsApp comments would be a little different. No, they would be a little bit more embarrassing to read if we were to mention all the temptations that we've had and that we've succumbed to, all those moments that we failed. We haven't been the people we ought to be. We haven't had the thoughts we ought to have had. We haven't done the deeds we ought to have done. Perhaps we've heard of blessings that some people have had, and instead of rejoicing with those that rejoice, we've let a root of envy take hold of us, and we've asked, why them? Why are they having things so well? Why does it always work out for them? And we've got this, we've got these problems, we've got these difficulties, we're struggling like this. Is God against us? Does he care more for them than he does for us? It may seem, you see, it may seem that God is against us. And it might have seemed for Jacob here that God was against him, was wrestling against him like an adversary. But really, God was teaching Jacob in this instance. He was helping Jacob and helping us, I think, to understand that though God is rich in blessing, though God is generous and gives and gives and gives again, God isn't a machine. God isn't a slot machine where you put your money in and you press the button and the cork comes out at the bottom. When you want it, as you need it, as simple as that. Our God is a God who cares for us. Our God is a God who wants to bless us as our God, as our Father. He wants us to know him as he blesses us, not just know the blessing, but to know him who is blessing us in this. And sometimes that can involve him dealing with us in a difficult way, so that we learn to call upon him, like Jacob, now calling, looking to him, looking to his promises, pleading with him, not letting him go. Sometimes it can be like that. And perhaps, this indeed may be one of the lessons of COVID for some of us. We've been struggling, we've been on our own, as Jacob was here on his own, and God has been dealing with us, and we've been learning to look to him, learning to look to our Heavenly Father to receive blessings from his hand. That's the second thing. And the third thing I'd like to note is that blessing is a good thing that God gives in his grace to be sought from him in weakness. In weakness. Perhaps as we hear that God is a God who blesses those who seek him, those who seek him find him, perhaps we feel, well, that's where I'm going wrong. That's where I'm going. There's so little prayer in my life, perhaps. All those prayers that there are superficial or half-hearted, lukewarm, mechanical, repetitious. I don't mean it. There's no ardor there. I'm just so weak. I feel that I can't do this. Perhaps this is what you've been feeling during COVID. Well, what do I know? And you know this. Your problem is not that you are too weak. Your problem, or our problem, is usually that we are too strong, at least in our own view. We think we can cope as we are. We think things are all right. We think we are all right. We don't need anything that much. Now, this has certainly became clear with certainly the beginning of the pandemic. You know, people were very, very worried, and people that you thought were quite jocose about life. And then all of a sudden, you know, these questions of life and death emerge, and, oh, they're concerned. Yeah, very, very concerned. They've taken all sorts of precautions to avoid any risk of catching this terrible disease. We can feel these things and feel our need in times of adversity. And this was the experience Jacob was given. You know, he's struggling there, and you think he would feel weak enough as he was. He didn't know how to cope. He didn't know how he was going to face his brother as he was. But he was holding on. But still, he was holding on, and the Lord, the angel, wrenched broke the hip, no hip operations in those days, he broke it, and he couldn't stand properly. The pain as well, no doubt, would affect him. It was very difficult. He couldn't even run away back to Laban if he wanted to. The Lord brought him to a place of weakness, not out of spite, not because he was playing with Laban, but because he wanted Jacob to see his weakness and to see where his faith was even in weakness. And we see this, don't we? We see Jacob's faith perhaps at its greatest here, at this moment of supreme, ultimate weakness. Though he's weak, though he can't stand straight, he's still holding. And he won't leave go unless the Lord blesses him. Unless this divine manifestation blesses him. He wants the blessing and he'll keep on even in weakness. And there's the lesson for us, isn't it? In our weakness. To see our weakness. Oh, that the Lord would show us our weakness. That we might call on him in weakness and see that God is merciful to the weak. It's not him that runneth, it's not him that walketh, it's not him that doeth. It's him who comes in weakness and calls in weakness. And this, I think, is very appropriate for us as a church. I'm here in the church building, on my own here. I can make as much noise as I want. Nobody's going to complain. But I can see the chairs in front of me, and I can imagine the people who were sitting there not so long, and indeed who are no longer with us. And for some, this time of COVID has been a time of bereavement. And of course, in bereavement, that can be a time of great weakness. The memories come flooding back, and the realization that's it, though that time, that chapter has ended. And it can be very painful, and it can be very difficult, and perhaps at this time when we're all isolated as well, even more difficult. Well, thankfully, in the light of this chapter, God can meet us in that weakness. And there are other examples. I won't elaborate on others, perhaps in case people think I'm picking on them, but you know what your life is like. You know what you're going through. You know where those areas of weakness are. And in your weakness, like Jacob, with nothing else, no, what else can you do? What answers have you got? How are you going to get through this? How are you going to cope? You can't. What can you do? But come to God in your weakness. Lay hold on him and say, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And this figure blesses Jacob. He receives a blessing. He doesn't get a new hip. He will never walk straight ever again. He'll bear that for the rest of his life. But he is under God's blessing. He's given a new name, Israel, a man who wrestled with God. All his past misdemeanors, All those things, all those skeletons in the closet, they're behind him. Now he is walking with God, somebody under the blessing of God. And there's, I think, great hope for us there as we look to the future and the new normal in front of us. What does it hold for us? What are the lessons that we've received? What are the knocks, perhaps, that we've received during COVID? Well, whatever they are, those things needn't take away from knowing the blessing of God. Now, the person who deals with Jacob here, deals with him, speaks to him, blesses him, and then leaves. Jacob asks, his name, Jacob, has been given a new name. He wants to know the name of this angel. And he isn't told the name. It wasn't the time yet to tell. But in this account, of course, we get these glimpses that we have throughout the Old Testament. God is preparing us for what is to come. Here he is coming close to Jacob in this incident. And in the fullness of time, he would come. In his goodness, he would come in the person, and we know his name, don't we? We don't have to ask who his name is. Jesus Christ, thou shalt call his name Jesus. He shall save his people from their sins. And whereas Jacob was injured in the hip, this one came not to injure us, he came to heal us. He came to be injured in our stead. He came not only to be injured, but indeed to be put to death in our stead, that through him we might know the blessing of God. We might know the blessing of God through COVID. We might know the blessing of God beyond COVID, throughout what remains of our life in this world, and one day forevermore with the blessed before the throne. Well, may God help us in the light of this passage to look to the God of Jacob, to look to the God of Abraham, to look to the God of Isaac, but to look more particularly to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, blesses us now and will bless us forevermore. Amen.